World War II saw the development of many new technologies like jet airplanes, ballistic missiles, magnetic mines, helicopters, and the atomic bomb. However, one of the most important inventions of the war wasn't a weapon at all. It was the practical usage of radio waves for radar, navigation, homing, etc. Throughout the war, Axis and Allied forces clashed using the most advanced electronic devices of the time. The British Prime Minister Winston Churchill, who was fascinated by new technologies, called this invisible yet decisive conflict the Wizard War. This video will cover the race in radar tech, attempts at jamming, navigation techniques, and ways they were spoofed. The Wizard War saw use of spoofing enemy communications and hijacking the data lines. That was in 1940s, so you can imagine how delicate data safety is today. Your IP address is usually visible to everyone, and most of the traffic your device does with the internet is not encrypted, so someone with appropriate software could intercept that traffic and track what you do, unless you use a virtual private network, like NordVPN, which is sponsoring this video. A NordVPN app on your phone or computer creates a secure encrypted tunnel between your device and the internet using its own special servers. And there's over 5,000 servers in 62 different countries to pick from, so you can pretend you're connecting from there. NordVPN has no bandwidth limits. It allows peer-to-peer sharing and the app is compatible with the likes of Android, iOS, macOS or Windows. And best of all, NordVPN is giving Binko viewers a special offer. Go to nordvpn.com/binkov and use the code BINKOV. You will get 70% off a 3-year plan and an extra month for free. Check out their rates and their offer by clicking the link below. Military strategists of the Second World War became concerned about fleets of enemy bombers, as they perceived bombers will always get through. Detecting enemy aircraft early and accurately became necessary. The invention of radar was almost an accident. By the mid-1930s, the British Air Ministry was increasingly concerned about the rumors that Germany was developing death ray technology. It eventually issued an open call, offering a reward of £1,000 to an inventor of a beam that could terminate a sheep from a distance of at least 100 yards. Robert Watson Watt and Arnold Wilkins were members of British Radio Research Station who tried using radios to create a death ray. Instead, they noticed how radio signals were often disturbed by the airplanes flying near the BBC radio towers. They began wondering if it was possible to detect incoming aircraft using radio signals. The government decided to finance further research of this new technology, calling it radio direction finding, or RDF. Initially, German radar technology was superior to the British one. However, Adolf Hitler himself wasn't interested in defensive technology. By the time World War II started, it was the British who had most successfully applied the new technology in the field. In 1940, devices of the British Chain Home Radar Network were primitive and cumbersome, using 300 feet tall towers with cables strung between them. The entire project was top secret. By July 1940, the German intelligence community was aware that the British possessed an early warning system. But they believed the British couldn't collect, filter and relay all the critical data to the fighter squadrons efficiently. But the British somehow managed. The RAF and the Air Ministry were acutely aware of this problem. In an age before computers, all intel about approaching enemy airplanes was relayed by telephone to fighter command headquarters. The HQ sifted through the collected data and forwarded info to group and sector headquarters. From there, the most relevant information was sent to local commanders. There were also the so-called Y stations, sites for collecting signals intelligence established way back during World War I. Those intercepted enemy radio communication and identified the location of their sources, conveying the information forward. Finally, there was Ultra. This was a British code name for a super secret signal intelligence obtained by breaking German high-level encrypted communication. All these various sources provided the RAF with plenty of warning about German air raids. The Battle of Britain was the first significant German defeat. It wouldn't be the last. By 1939, the Luftwaffe also began experimenting with radio navigation. The earliest such system was Knickerbein, or Crooked Leg. It consisted of two aerials projecting radio beams hundreds of miles away. Those intersected above the target. Bombers would follow one of the beams until they intercepted the second one, which meant they were above their destination. This allowed even night attacks, while avoiding detection and air defense. British physicist Reginald Victor Jones gathered data from Ultra and Oslo Report, a leak by renegade German scientist H.F. Mayer. After studying the German system found aboard a downed enemy bomber, Jones discovered that the device was far too sensitive for mere landing equipment. From there, he posited the existence of targeting and navigation systems using radio beams. Churchill ordered further research, and the British codenamed it Headache. The Air Ministry almost discontinued the investigation after some critics argued such radio beams were unusable due to the curvature of the Earth. And yet the RAF sent several airplanes equipped with US-made amateur receiving sets to try and locate this theoretical signal over Britain. They discovered radio beams intersecting above the Rolls-Royce factory at Derby, where engines for British fighter planes were made. The Air Ministry instantly began developing countermeasures in an operation fittingly called Aspirin. At first, the British used Y stations to interfere with German radio beams. Later, they started emitting fake beam signals to confuse enemy pilots. Before long, the Luftwaffe introduced an alternative system called X-Gerät, or X-Apparatus. Bomber airplanes would follow a single radio beam. It was intersected by a series of beams at the distances of 40, 10 and 5 kilometers from the bombing target. The Luftwaffe equipped an experimental air group with the system. Their mission was to fly in front of the main force and drop flares on targets to help other attackers. Germans used X-Gerät in a series of night raids they codenamed Moonlight Sonata. After the bombing of Birmingham in November 1940, the analysis demonstrated accuracy even daytime air attacks rarely achieved. Once again, it didn't take long for Jones and the British to devise a countermeasure. And once again, a downed German bomber equipped with an X-Gerät device helped solve the puzzle. In response, the British started emitting fake radio crossbeams. German airplanes would intercept them earlier than the genuine ones, assume they were near targets, and release bombs in the middle of nowhere. By this time, Jones anticipated that the Germans might try another system and began developing countermeasures in advance. The so-called Y-Gerät used a complex signal consisting of two parts. The first one helped airplanes stay on course. Equipment aboard the plane resent the second part using a marginally different frequency as soon as it was received. The phase difference between the original and the re-radiated signal increased as the bomber flew away from the ground station, indicating its distance. When the bomber was over the target, the flight crew would receive a radio command to drop the bombs. Coincidentally, the Luftwaffe chose to operate the system at the same frequency as the BBC television transmitter at Alexandra Palace. The British retransmitted the airplane signal while modifying its phase shift and transit delay. This caused confusion between German pilots and ground crews, who accused each other of the failures of the Y-Gerät. After the Germans realized their plans were foiled, they gave up on radio navigation. The Wizard War then shifted to the Atlantic. German warships, mostly submarines, tried to sink ships bringing resources for the British wartime economy. Meanwhile, allies, mostly the British and later US forces, were protecting the shipping lanes. This was yet another war theater where radar proved itself invaluable. 2 years prior to the war, the British were already experimenting with the first air-to-air radar. However, these early devices were all but useless for pinpointing other airplanes during flight. The engineers did notice radars were able to detect large surface objects like buildings, coastal cranes and ships. During the naval maneuvers in September 1937, airplane crews not only located Navy warships despite overcast weather, but also used radar to navigate their way back to the airfield. Instead of spotting enemy aircraft, the RAF Coastal Command used early air-to-air detectors to find German U-boats. Air-to-surface vessel radar, or ASV Mark I, came out in 1940. The modified Mark II version followed a year later. Both devices used long wavelengths. The crews flying patrol bombers could detect enemy submarines at a distance, but they would lose them as they approached them. In response, the Kriegsmarine began using a radar detector, made by a company called Metox. By detecting radar signals long before the British patrol bombers even came close to them, German submarines were able to submerge in time and disappear. This made ASV useless and caused plenty of grief for the British. But thanks to decrypted Enigma messages, British forces continued finding German submarines. This, combined with a misleading testimony by a captured British RAF officer, convinced the Germans that the enemy was somehow able to detect emissions produced by the Mattox detector itself. By August 1943, Kriegsmarine ordered all U-boats to stop using Mattox. And just like that, ASV Mark II became useful once again. By the time the Germans realized their mistake, it had been too late. And then there was H2S. Thanks to a cavity magnetron, it used a microwave frequency in the 10 cm band. Adopted by the Coastal Command as ASV Mark III, it was all but impossible to detect with a Mattox radar detector. Even worse for the Kriegsmarine, Mark III was able to detect U-boats' periscope or snorkel. The German Navy tried adapting the radar detector used by their night fighters to locate British bombers by their radar signal. However, its range was far too short. It was only in 1943 that Germany managed to field a radar detector sensitive enough to detect ASV Mark III radar. That was the Naxos radar detector. But by then the tide of war against Germany had already changed, and defeat was slowly becoming inevitable. The Germans did try using radar-absorbing coating on their snorkels. By 1943, they achieved a reduction in detection range from 8 miles to just 1 mile. But the coatings didn't adhere well in the ocean environment, and eventually their efficiency would degrade. Radar wasn't the only type of electronic equipment used during the Battle of the Atlantic. There was a high-frequency radio detector device known as HAFDAF. HAFDAF was used to detect and locate lightning strikes. It turned out this device was able to locate enemy radios using high frequencies to communicate over long distances. HAFDAFs were widely used on warships and airplanes. Devices like Germany's Freya radar were superior to the equivalent British models. However, the German command at first showed no interest in the further development of radar. Furthermore, its use was hampered by the inter-service rivalry that plagued Germany's supposedly well-oiled war machine. Hermann Göring only learned about German radar systems 3 years after Kriegsmarine's Kühnhold successfully demonstrated his device. Even worse, Kühnhold refused to share his results with Telefunken, a company working on a radar device called Würzburg. By the middle of the war, Germany was falling behind in radar technology. They did not have a working cavity magnetron radar, important for achieving short wavelengths and thus high precision, until they had a lucky break. One British aircraft crash-landed in German territory in 1943 with intact H2S radar. Germans used it to help develop own similar radars, but still it took time. First reliable such radars were fielded in 1945. Back at the start of the war, as the Germans began deploying their radars in the field, the RAF launched reconnaissance missions to photograph them. Next, commanders sent Vickers Wellington bombers equipped with wideband receivers to perform signals intelligence over occupied Europe. These ferrets picked up Freya's 2.4 meter emissions and Würzburg's 50 centimeter signals. All this led to Operation Biting in February 1942. In a daring commando mission, British paratroopers landed near a radar station in France and took some of the equipment, while photographing the rest. The commandos even managed to kidnap one of the German radar technicians. Eventually, it was time for the Germans to defend against Allied bomber raids. The Kammhubar line, a system stretching across all of northern France, Belgium, the Netherlands, southern Denmark and northwestern Germany, was devised. The Kammhubar line organized its defense into a series of squares. Within each square there was a pair of night fighters, Freya radar connected to a master searchlight, and several manually operated smaller searchlights. Over time, the Kammhubar line expanded inwards towards Germany, growing several boxes deep. The system was remarkably efficient against solitary enemy bombers. RAF Bomber Command soon started flying in large formations, overwhelming the individual squares. In response, the Germans expanded the line further, adding more radar devices. In 1941, they introduced Würzburg Riese, essentially the same old Würzburg, but with an extended range and a much bigger radar dish. By 1942, the Luftwaffe began equipping its night fighters with their first airborne interception radars. The Germans used Liechtenstein radars until the end of the war, frequently alongside devices like the aforementioned Mattox radar detector. The Air Ministry and the RAF reacted by developing creative new ways of blinding and confusing German air defenses. The British equipped entire air squadrons with a special US-built radar jammer codenamed Mandrel. It directly targeted Freya and Würzburg machines. Jammed, radar would basically see a lot of noise over the whole area, instead of dots representing planes. Furthermore, there was RAID, an Allied radar detection and homing device used for targeting enemy night fighters. And then there was Operation Corona, in which native German speakers employed by the RAF issued false radio commands to night fighters intercepting Allied bombers. As a response, the Luftwaffe replaced all of its male radio operatives with women. The RAF did the same and resumed the operation. It was a never-ending battle of ingenuity and innovation, measures and countermeasures. And yet there was one scheme so devious, both sides were reluctant to use it. Once more, it was Reginald Victor Jones who came up with this idea as early as 1937. During the war, the trick, codenamed Window, was further developed by Joan Curran, a lone female among British electronic warfare experts. The idea was as brilliant as it was straightforward. Drop thousands of thin pieces of aluminium foil from airplanes to confuse and blind enemy radars. In fact, the British found the idea too brilliant. Since the RAF lacked any countermeasures to it, the command was worried Germans would use the same idea themselves. Except that the Luftwaffe came up with this trick too. Goering promptly suppressed it, afraid the Allies would start using it. The RAF eventually deployed Window during the devastating firebombing of Hamburg in July 1943. Afterward, the British and US bombers continued using aluminium chaff until the end of the war. In the weeks before the invasion of Normandy in June 1944, the Allies bombed critical radar stations to prevent the Germans from noticing the Allied fleet too early. Furthermore, Allies devised two chief countermeasures: hiding the real invasion fleet while simultaneously creating a fake one to confuse the Germans. On the day of the invasion, June 6, 1944, entire squadrons of airplanes screened the airborne assault force and the naval force by utilizing Mandrel radar jammers. Others dropped a variation of Window called Rope, aluminium strips long enough to jam the signal of Freya radars. Both airplanes and ships used powerful radio jammers to block German communication. Meanwhile, groups of boats and planes, codenamed Taxable and Glimmer, were to fool German radar stations. By flying in a certain pattern over the sea and dropping rope, bombers produced what on radar appeared like a surface fleet moving towards the continent. Boats with radar reflectors made their radar return bigger than it would otherwise be. Glimmer flew towards Boulogne, 185 miles to the east from the real invasion site. The second group was far more successful, playing into German expectations about Allies using the shortest route to cross the sea between Britain and Europe. The British had also equipped several of their Typhoon fighters with radar homing devices called Abdallah. Then they located the German air defense radars in Normandy so they could attack them. Those were early examples of SEAD operations. By the end of the war, Allied bombing wrecked both the German forces and their industry. To the very end, the Germans kept experimenting with new types of radar devices, jammers and detectors. However, they lacked so many necessary components, they had to scavenge them from destroyed Allied airplanes. Ultimately, it was the side with the better wizards that won the war. And remember, Binkov may talk about hypothetical wars, but only real peace can bring us all together.